The walnut comb is one of the most confusing comb types out there for those looking to bring the walnut comb into a new breed, due to the amount of variation and variety of comb types that can come out of it. According to the American Poultry Association, the walnut comb is the accepted comb type for Silkies, Orloffs, Yokohamas, and Malays in North America, although in Malays it is referred to as the strawberry comb. The genetics of the walnut comb are more complex compared to most comb types, as the walnut comb is not caused by one gene, but instead the combined effects of both a rose comb and a pea comb. As many breeders of satins know, the comb can be one of the most challenging things to get right after outcrossing due to the complexity of the genetics. In this video, we will discuss the genetics of the rose comb, the genetics of the pea comb, how to get a walnut comb, and lastly, four common breeding examples of dihybrid crosses related to the walnut comb. Because two genes are involved here, making it a dihybrid cross, it gets a lot more complicated when using a Punnett square. Although I will be showing a Punnett square on screen, I'll have the different genotypes and correlating phenotypes written nearby. With all that covered, let's first take a look at the genetics of the rose comb. The rose comb is a completely dominant allele over the single comb. Keep in mind that there can be quite a variation in the different phenotypes of rose combs, whether the main spike in the back, called the leader, points upwards or follows the shape of the neck. We also see variation in the texture of the comb, whether it is rough or smooth. Rose combs also tend to have something called a trifid, three spikes on the back of the comb when a crest is present. Sometimes only two spikes are present, and sometimes you can see four. Because there is a lot of variation in the way these are expressed, we will be saving these topics for another video, as they do not really concern us in the basic context of the walnut comb, but it is all something to keep in mind. The symbol for a rose comb is a capital R, and the symbol for the absence of the rose comb is a lowercase r with a plus sign afterwards to represent that the absence of a rose comb, usually a single comb, is the wild type that we see in red jungle fowl. Keep in mind that single combs are recessive to rose combs. Because a rose comb is completely dominant, meaning it is generally expressed the same regardless of whether a bird is homozygous or heterozygous for a rose comb, we need to be careful to know the lineage of the birds we are using to determine what the comb type of the offspring will be. We will cover the genetics of the rose comb in more detail in another video, but to quickly summarize it, a homozygous rose comb bird bred to a bird with a single comb will have 100% heterozygous rose-combed offspring. A heterozygous rose-combed bird bred to a bird with a single comb will have 50% heterozygous rose-combed offspring and 50% homozygous single-combed offspring. When two birds, each having a heterozygous rose comb, are bred together, 25% of the offspring will be homozygous for a rose comb, 50% will be heterozygous for a rose comb, and 25% will be homozygous for a single comb. And remember, you probably won't be able to tell the homozygous and heterozygous rose combed offspring apart, which is why it's so important to keep good records. Again, it is very important when breeding, especially to those of you who are breeding satins, that you know if your birds are homozygous or heterozygous for the rose comb, as well as the pea comb, which we will discuss next. If they are not, you could be unknowingly breeding and selling eggs that hatch single-combed offspring, which is a disqualification in the American Silkie standard. With all of that covered, next, let's move on to the genetics of the pea comb. The pea comb allele is incompletely dominant over the single comb allele. The gene symbol for the pea comb is a capital P, and the gene symbol for the absence of the pea comb, which in most cases is a single comb, is a lowercase p with a plus sign afterwards to represent that it is the wild type. Because the pea comb allele is incomplete dominant, when a bird that is homozygous for a pea comb is crossed to a bird that is homozygous for a single comb, the offspring tend to have a single blade pea comb, a blend between the two. Rather than the pea comb being expressed as one larger central row with a smaller row on each side, as a homozygous pea comb bird would have, on a heterozygote, the middle row is significantly larger and the smaller side rows are not present. If you breed two birds that are heterozygous for a pea comb together, 25% of the offspring should be homozygous for a pea comb, 50% should be heterozygous for a pea comb, meaning they have that single blade pea comb, and 25% should be homozygous for the absence of a pea comb, which is usually a single comb. Another thing worth noting about the pea comb is that the presence of the pea comb reduces the size of the wattles. This is much more noticeable when the pea comb is homozygous. For those of you breeding non-bearded silkies, this should be of great help when determining the genotype of the birds you are working with. Unfortunately, this is of little help in bearded silkies because the presence of the beard already also inhibits wattle growth. And lastly, before we move on to the main topic of walnut combs, it is important to note how the crest affects the expression of a single comb. Oftentimes, a crest will make the single comb fold together and form more of a Z shape. This can be hard to identify, and sometimes silkies with single combs do express them as normal single combs, so you have to be alert in knowing what comb types you're working with when forming your breeding pens. If you are unsure what type of comb a bird has, you can always perform a test cross to confirm or deny your suspicions. And finally, with all of that covered, let's take a look at the walnut comb. As stated earlier in this video, the walnut comb is caused by the combination of the rose comb and the pea comb. A bird with a walnut comb must have at least one rose comb allele and one pea comb allele. According to the American Bantam Association's book titled Silkies, the walnut comb is ideally shaped when a bird is pure, or homozygous, for both the rose comb and the pea comb. Although you can get a walnut comb with the genotype big R, little R, and big P, little P, or big R, big P, little P, or big R, big P, big P, this means that the genotype big R, big P, big P will give you the best walnut combs. With all this information, you should have all the information necessary to determine the type of offspring we'll get based on the parents. With two genes involved, though, it's a lot of information to consider, so for this reason, I highly recommend using a dihybrid cross calculator instead of trying to work it out in your head or by hand. This, of course, only works if you know the genotypes of the parents, but if you do, it's a great tool. I'll leave the link to a few different calculators in the description. For those of you that are familiar with the multiplication method, or if you aren't already, I would highly recommend using that as well, as that can really help narrow down the genotypic and phenotypic ratios of the offspring. With all this in mind, let's go over the four most common pairings that we often see when breeders are getting into silkies and satins. Firstly, let's look at the results of the common cross to make F1 satins, breeding true exhibition quality silkies with homozygous walnut combs to Cochins, which have single combs. The first cross is a bird that is homozygous for both the rose comb allele and the pea comb allele, meaning it has a pure walnut comb, bred to a bird that has a single comb, meaning it is homozygous for the absence of a rose comb, and homozygous for the absence of a pea comb. This cross should produce 100% walnut-combed offspring, but all will be heterozygous for both the rose comb and pea combed alleles, with a genotype of R/r and P/p. So they will have walnut combs, but they may not be as nice as their parent's walnut comb or the ideal walnut comb. The second common cross is essentially an F2 satin offspring that you would have gotten from the first pairing, which would be heterozygous for both the rose and pea comb, bred to a Cochin or other single comb bird that would have a genotype of r/r and p/p. In this cross, from the parent that is heterozygous from the pea comb and rose comb, which would be your F2 satin offspring, 50% of the time their offspring will inherit the rose comb allele from them, and 50% of the time their offspring will inherit the lowercase r allele, which is the allele for the absence of the single comb from them. 50% of the time, the same parent will give their pea-combed allele to their offspring, and 50% of their time, their offspring will inherit the lowercase p allele, or the allele for the absence of the pea comb from them. Because the other parent has a single comb, they will only ever pass the little r and little p alleles for the absence of rose comb and pea comb, respectively. If we use the multiplication method, or just by looking at the Punnett square, we can see that there are four possible outcomes. 25% of offspring should be heterozygous for both the rose comb and pea comb, meaning they have a walnut comb. 25% should be heterozygous for a rose comb, but homozygous for the absence of pea comb. These should have a rose comb. 25% of offspring will be heterozygous for a pea comb, but homozygous for the absence of a rose comb, meaning they will have the heterozygous single-bladed pea comb. And the remaining 25% of offspring will be homozygous for the absence of both the rose and pea comb, meaning they will have a single comb. The third common cross is two birds that are both heterozygous for a rose comb and heterozygous for a pea comb. This cross is going to give you every possible genotypic combination. Both parents in this case have a walnut comb, and when bred together, will give these different combinations shown on screen. There are four different genotypes here in the offspring that will result in a walnut comb. The first, a bird that is homozygous for both the rose and pea comb, meaning they should have the ideal walnut comb, has a genotype of R, big P, big P. Roughly 6.25% of offspring will have this genotype. The second possible genotype for a walnut-combed offspring from this pair is big R, big P, little p. homozygous for a rose comb, but heterozygous for a peat comb. 12.5% of offspring should have this genotype. The third possibility is big R, little r, big P, heterozygous for a rose comb, but homozygous for a peat comb. Roughly 12.5% of offspring should come out this way. The fourth possible genotype that could create a walnut comb would be big R, big P, little p, meaning they are heterozygous for both a rose comb and pea comb. Roughly 25% of offspring should come out this way. When you add all these percentages together, you should see that 56.25% of offspring from this pairing will have a walnut comb. There are two different genotypes from this pairing that could result in rose-combed offspring. One is big R, little p, which should occur in 6.25% of the offspring, and the other is big R, little p, which should occur in 12.5% of the offspring. So in total, 18.75% of offspring should be rose-combed. There are also two genotypes from this cross that could result in a pea comb. One is little r, big p, which would result in a homozygous pea comb, which should occur in 6.25% of the offspring, and the other is little r, big p, little p, which should give a heterozygous pea comb in 12.5% of the offspring. This adds up to 18.75%. Because pea combs are incomplete nominate, this heterozygous pea comb does not look the same as a homozygous one. And lastly, 6.5% of the offspring from this cross should be homozygous for the absence of both a pea comb and a rose comb, meaning they have a genotype of little r, little p, and therefore would have a single comb. As you can see from all the genotypes and corresponding photos in this pairing, you can expect to see loads of variation in this cross. The last pairing we will discuss is how to create chickens that have a walnut comb from scratch. The best way to do this is to breed a bird that is homozygous for a rose comb to a bird that is homozygous for a pea comb. From this cross, 100% of offspring should have a genotype of big R, big P, little p, meaning they are heterozygous for a walnut comb. And with all that covered, we can wrap up this incredibly complex genetic topic. Overall, getting the comb right on a Silkie can be very challenging. Even when the genes are there, that doesn't mean they will always express the way that we desire in a show setting. In addition to that, getting the color right on the comb takes some work as well, which is a topic we will save for a later date. And not to mention the defects that can occur on the comb, like horns protruding from a comb or a lopped comb. However, when you get all the elements in place on a Silkie comb, they can be quite the showstopper. Thank you so much for watching, and if you have any questions, feel free to comment with them or contact me via any of the methods linked in the description. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video.